Welcome to our last subtopic in the topic integration, where we are looking at application of integration to velocity and acceleration. This is going to be a very easy part to do because bulk of the work has been done. We already understand the process of integration, which is just adding one to the power of each term and dividing by the new power. We have looked at definite and indefinite integrals, and we have now looked at area under curve. So this part is just application of all that we have learned, but with specific reference to velocity and acceleration. We are going to go back a little to the topic differentiation, where we learned in application of differentiation to velocity and acceleration, we learned that the derivative of a displacement function gives us velocity function, and the derivative of a velocity function gives us acceleration function. We have noted it here that the derivative of a displacement function gives velocity function, while the derivative of a velocity function gives an acceleration function. But the reverse is true, because we had said that integration is the reverse process of differentiation. It means, therefore, that in integration, the integral of an acceleration function gives us velocity. Meaning that if we have a function for acceleration, we can integrate to get a velocity function. And if we have a velocity function, we can integrate to get a displacement function, just reversing the process. Look at this. I'm just illustrating the process that under differentiation, if you have displacement, you can move to velocity, and from velocity to acceleration. The process through which you do that is differentiation. That arrow shows it all. When you have integration, you can move from acceleration back to displacement through velocity. That process through which we move back from acceleration to velocity to displacement is integration. And it all goes to confirm that integration is the reverse process of differentiation. I want us to look at four quick examples here and see where we are applying integration to velocity and acceleration. Example number one, the velocity v meters per second of a moving particle after t seconds is given by v is equal to 2t cubed plus t squared minus 1. Find the distance covered by the particle between t is equal to 1 and t is equal to 3. We are integrating the function 2t cubed plus t squared minus 1 with respect to t. The limits of integration are given from t is equal to 1 to t is equal to 3. That is what we are doing here. Limits from 1 to 3. We integrate that. The next process is applying the process of differentiation by adding 1 to the power, dividing by the new power, inserting limits from 1 to 3. It is the same thing here, only that we have now simplified 2 and 4 so that we have 1 and 2 in the denominator. So we have t power 4 over 2, t power 3 over 3, minus t. Limits from 1 to 3. I want you to master the process of integration so that when you see these things, you follow with ease. The next step is substitution. The first bracket is substitution of 3 where there is t. The second bracket is substitution of 1 where there is t. And finally, you end up with 46 and a half in the first bracket minus 1 over 6 in the second bracket. When you open that bracket, you will add. So you'll end up with 46 and 2 over 3. That is the distance covered by the particle between t is equal to 1 and t is equal to 3. I forgot to add the unit meters, but even without the unit, it is still correct, 46 and 2 over 3. Let us look at example number 2. A particle moving in a straight line passes through a fixed point O with a velocity of 9 meters per second. The acceleration of the particle t seconds after passing through O is given by 10 minus 2t meters per second squared. Find the velocity of the particle when t is equal to 3 seconds. We are now given acceleration and they want us to get the velocity of the particle. So the first thing we must get the velocity function from the acceleration function. And you can see, I've indicated here, that we are integrating velocity is equal to the integral of 10 minus 2t with respect to t. You can see no limits have been put because that is an indefinite integral. And you can therefore see that after integration, we have a c. But when we were looking at integration, we say that further information can be given to help us get c. And this question has further information to help us get c. You can go back here and see that with a velocity of 9. As it passes point O, it already has a velocity of 9. Meaning that the initial velocity of this particle is 9. That is for physics students, but not all of us are physics students, so we need to know how to apply that 9 to help us get our C. That 9 means that at t is equal to 0, velocity is 9. The initial velocity is 9. At initial velocity, time is 0. So at the fixed point O, t is equal to 0. That is why we are saying that when t is equal to 0, v is equal to 9. So that in our general function for velocity, we can now substitute v is 9, is equal to 10, and because t is now 0, 0 minus 0 squared plus c. And when we do that, it implies that c is equal to 9. Then we can now write the velocity function as v is equal to 10t minus t squared plus 9. This is now the specific velocity function which we have got after getting the value of c. But for physics students, you may not even do this substitution, because when they are given that through a fixed point O with a velocity of 9, they will already know that c is 9, because c in that velocity function is initial velocity, which is 9. So they will move straight away and write v is equal to 10t minus t squared plus 9, which is now the velocity function. And now when t is equal to 3, what is the velocity? So when t is equal to 3, it means where there is t, we put 3. Substitution now. When we do that, we end up with v is equal to 30 meters per second. In our third example, the question is in part A, B Roman 1 and B Roman 2. But let us start with part A. We already told that a particle moves in a straight line and passes through a point O with a velocity of 5 meters per second, which now rings the bell in the minds of some of us. The acceleration of the particle t seconds after passing through O is given by A is equal to 6t plus 4. This is the acceleration function. Express the velocity of the particle at time t seconds in terms of t seconds. So again, that is an indefinite integral. So we are saying that velocity is equal to the integral of 6t plus 4 dt. In the next step, we are integrating. So we have 6 over 2t t squared 4t plus c, a general velocity function which has been simplified in this step here. But we are again noting that when t is equal to 0, V is equal to 5. So that when we substitute in this general function, we end up with C is equal to 5. And so the velocity function is V is equal to 3t squared plus 4t plus 5. This is the velocity function. In part B, we are now asked to calculate the velocity of the particle when t is equal to 3. This is the velocity function that we have found in part A. We are now just substituting where there is t, we put 3. So 3 into 3 squared plus 4 into 3 plus 5. We simplify and we end up with 44 meters per second. In Roman 2, we are asked to calculate the distance covered by the particle between t is equal to 2 and t is equal to 4. Remember, now we have a velocity function, which is 3t squared plus 4t plus 5. Limits of integration are now given from 2 to 4. We are getting displacement, which is denoted by S. So, limits from 2 to 4, the integral of 3t squared plus 4t plus 5 with respect to time. The first part here is integration, adding 1 to the power, dividing by the new power, inserting limits from 2 to 4. We end up here in a simplified form, limits from 2 to 4. Here is now simplification, substitution. In the first bracket where there is t, we put 4. In the second bracket where there is t, we put 2. We are continuing to simplify. The first bracket will end up with 116. The second bracket we shall end up with 26. Then our distance is 90 meters after simplification. Our last example. A particle moves in a straight line from a fixed point. Its velocity v meters per second after t seconds is given by, we are now given a velocity function, calculate the distance traveled by the particle during the third second. I've wrote out this so that we understand the meaning of the third second. I want you to know that from 0 to 1 is called the first second, from 1 to 2 is called the second second, and from 2 to 3 is called the third second. That means we are integrating with the limits from 2 to 3 seconds. The function 90 squared minus 40 plus 1 with respect to time. This is the integral. The limits have been inserted. Upper limit being 3, the lower limit being 2. A simplified form of the integral, same limits. But this line now is substitution, where in the first bracket where there is t, we put 3. In the second bracket where there is t, we put 2. We are simplifying. We have 66 minus 18. We have 48 meters. So I want us to understand that integration can be applied in velocity and acceleration, just like differentiation could be applied in velocity and acceleration. The most important part of this topic, which I want all of us to understand, is that we must understand the process of integration. The other aspects are arithmetics. So let us understand the process of integration, understand it well, so that when we apply it in getting definite integrals, we are able to follow the process, simplification, and then we continue. When we apply it in determination of areas, then we are able to understand, first of all, the correct process before we come to substitution. And finally, when we apply it in velocity and acceleration, we understand the process, we only move ahead to substitute, simplify, and get. Having gone through this topic, I want to confirm to you, like I told you at the beginning, that this is one of the easiest topics in the world. It only takes practice to master it. Now you have the power to go through all the questions in this topic. I know you may find some of them challenging. Where you find some of them challenging, feel free to consult so that we guide you through. But the most basic and important aspects of this topic we have already looked at. As we end, I want you to go and look at questions, particularly the questions that were touching on the area under curve where curve sketching was required. Because we didn't do so many examples there. Sketch the curve, know the clear region, determine the area. This marks the end of our topic integration. I want to thank you so much for listening to me, and I want to look at the last exercise in that KLB, exercise 10.4, which runs from page 238 to 239. Now that you are at home, you have enough time to look at the questions number 1 to number 9. Then look at the various ways through which this question has been tested, even in the past KCSE exams. You will find it's a very, very simple topic, and you can clear all the questions coming from this topic. From the next program, we shall be posting to you questions touching on this area and also touching on area approximations so that it helps you to understand these questions deeply. Thank you so much for listening to me, and may God bless you abundantly.